So, hello everyone, and this is the first episode of ArtHlib, which is a multimedia archive showcasing creative Ukrainians who collect the harvest of their journey or those still sculpting their recipe to success. And the details you will know now. Both of us are from Lviv, Ukraine, and we didn't know each other until we moved to London, until quite recently, to be honest. Now, I want to ask you first question. I know that you've your first kind of creative direction was fashion and styling, and you went to Institute Marangoni, and you started your path in Milan.
No.
Didn't you?
No, I started in London. So it's actually not the first time me doing some creative stuff. So I went to Ukrainian Lviv Art School for many years. I don't remember how many. And when I was finishing my school, I was 16. I wasn't sure what I'd do. And my mom told me about that uni, about fashion. I wasn't really kind of understanding was what I'm going to apply for, but I went for foundation in London, and then they kind of offered me to go to Milan for 1 year and come back to London. So that's why I decided to go for styling. There were also fashion business and design, but I wasn't really sure that I want to create clothes, and I wasn't really sure that I want to just sit and write business. So with styling, it was like a golden middle, if I can say so. So that's why it's how it started.
So this wasn't really your conscious decision to go directly in fashion, and that was your mom influence?
I actually was really quiet kid when I was at school. I wasn't sure what I want to do. My family are lawyers, but I was going to the art school, and they were like happy for me to do anything I want. So that's why my mom kind of offered me a few unis.
And so basically, tell me about what was your impression of fashion styling. What was your picture of fashion styling when you were going to university, and what you felt like doing styling while you were already experienced in that?
So I did a few summer camps in Cambridge, Oxford, and different UK-based camps for art.
They were based in styling as well?
No, not styling, in art. So it was illustration, okay, different things, and I was expecting that it's going to be really similar. And then we started doing sketchbooks, matching clothes, and doing really similar program to design. And then I wasn't familiar with the industry at all, so I started doing different internships, because when I was at school, I wasn't working at all. I was going to different professors, just like additional classes, and I was doing different sports, arts. So I wasn't really working when I was 16. When I arrived, I started volunteering for fashion weeks in a backstage, then assisting different stylists. So kind of different free jobs, if you can call them like this.
Did you find it challenging to find a job?
In London, no. Because it's so easy in Milan as well, so you just have connections and you build your connection in uni. You meet people, they are telling about some alumni of different universities who they know who are like working in the industry and so on. So you can easily and find, use LinkedIn, different Facebook groups for fashion, and then you can just find any open calls for volunteers. I think right now it's much more easier because everyone's using social medias. In 2017 it wasn't so popular. Of course everyone was doing different Instagrams, blogs and stuff, and it was like a huge trend in the beginning. It was like a beginning of influence of Instagram on fashion and like all creative industries. But right now you can even find the groups where even Instagrams with the jobs titles and salary and stuff. You showed me one.
It's actually created by one of the alumni.
I know.
of UIL. I know that you did quite a bit of independent projects back in Ukraine where you were styling and like directing them. You had some experience doing photography. how did you find that not really inspiration, but I know that you were telling me that you were a shy kid and you didn't really know what you were doing when you went to uni. How did you find that path that you wanted to follow within your creativity?
So actually, when I just arrived to London, I was 16 or 17. I started to live in accommodation. So I met a lot of people. I started drinking, going to parties, dating guys, and not many, actually. But still, you kind of communicate with people, you do connections and stuff. So in the end, you're kind of opening up to new opportunities, and it's easier for you to think about projects you're going to do. And also, when you're a student, you need to do fashion shoots, fashion videos and different stuff. But you don't have any photographers or makeup artists offered by uni, or they can offer you, but you need to pay them. Or usually you cooperate with different students from other unis or any people who can do makeup or do photography or video. So I started doing photo shoots myself, and it's how kind of my career of fashion photographer started. I started doing shoots for other students, just like growing my portfolio. So, but when I was in my third year, I was doing my diploma. I needed to do like 8 or 10 shoots and video, and I decided that I'm gonna just find people and pay them in order to get a really good content. So for example, one of my projects, the person that you're gonna talk is Savka, the model. She was one of the models for my shoot. Also the photographer was Ulyana Batyuk, which is also a really famous Ukrainian photographer right now, like especially in our city and Eastern European accent. So you just rather pay or do it yourself. So that's why you need to find the ways to finish your projects and not to be kicked out of uni. And also there is an inside joke of my uni that rather, if you go to our uni, you rather stay in the, and you get in love, no, make
fall in love,
fall in love with the career, or you're gonna hate it. So I was a different type. I started hating fashion, so that's why I moved to art.
What was your biggest challenge in your sort of fashion, styling, photography career?
So I started doing different projects with Ukrainian designers and different people from Ukraine. I realized they don't want to pay you, and my studies wasn't so cheap. And in the end, you just feel that you're not useless. You're just like people are using you. And for example, the London gallerist art dealer that I'm working for right now, the British one, but he works with Ukrainian and Eastern European art. When I was doing my interview for the dissertation, he told me that because he cooperates and works with Ukrainians a lot, because he works with Ukrainian art, obviously. So he told me the phrase that in Ukraine, everyone is trying to make loch of you, and you can explain it.
Yeah, loch is a sort of a very dialectic name for a loser.
Yeah, so when you're just a young green professional, you can't just like have a good salary and good reputation. You need to have your portfolio, connections, and then maybe you can build up and make your business.
Even profound, quite big photographers and stylists, I'm pretty sure there are like dozens of them, not even hundreds, and not even them have a standard of salary that people in the UK have. So
So that was the reason I decided to move. And then after bachelor's, I realized that I'm really young. I was just 20 when I finished, and I was like, I'm not ready to go and work. I'm not sure, like, of course after my uni you can have all the experience and skills you need in order to work in the industry, but it wasn't enough for me, and I wasn't sure if I want to work there. I was just hopeless at the time. And then I decided that I want to do something else. I was thinking about finance, like master's in finance, or any
That's a big switch.
Yeah, so that's why I kind of realized that I don't want to switch something like radically, and I will go to the art business, which I started doing a year ago, and I just finished a few months ago.
So I want you to tell a couple of words about your university, SOTBIS. So basically tell people, me, what SOTBIS is in general, and how did you choose that uni? How did you get in? How did you come across? Because I feel like it's a very niche sort of thing. And basically, I haven't heard about it until I met you.
So actually in art, like how art business is working, you have rather dealers, art dealers. Let's not mess up with something else. So you have gallerists, managers, different, there's also some things like restoration, authenticity, and people who are just working with this. But it's,
and restoration, I think, as well.
Yeah, so it's different things that you can do in art, not just like drawings and paintings and stuff. Artists, of course, it's the biggest, the most important thing for art industry.
The harvest of the business.
Yeah, but they usually don't earn a lot. Maybe
unfortunately.
The,
so
the
basically, it's
one.
Your job to make them earn a lot.
Yeah, that's right. And then you have auction houses, which is the places where you can sell your art, and they are very old ones, such as Christie's and Sotheby's. So my uni is Sotheby's Institute of Art, which is kind of art business oriented on different kind of spheres, not just auction houses like many others. In your interview, they're showing you and asking you some different questions about art business, and you're answering that, and also you write essay for them. Then you also need to have IELTS test, but because I was studying in UK, I don't need it. So yeah, it's pretty simple when you kind of have experience there, and you need to know art history is one of the most important thing. Or you can take, if you are from finance or any other discipline, you need to go through the small at least 3 months course of art history. But it wasn't,
yeah, I think how it works in Ukrainian unis, you basically have to retake certain
classes.
Curriculum classes to then be able to transfer, and it's pretty much the same thing. You kind of take the course over the summer and then you can transfer to university. What was the biggest difference between both universities, second, bachelor diploma in general and master's diploma in general in the creative industry? I think it's a very kind of meaningful question, because my personal opinion is master's is much more academic, and I saw you working on that. And guys, this is insane. This person had like this big stacks of paper, and she would be just reading through all those articles. I'm not even mentioning the amount of interviews done. But yeah, I feel like that's my opinion, and I want you to elaborate on that.
So I think because styling a creative direction is not so academic, so of course you write essays for art history and do some different practical classes, but it's more you doing shoots, styling, studying some basic stuff, Photoshop. So you kind of work more with this kind of soft skill. No, it's not soft skills.
Yeah,
like
it's hard skills.
Hard skills. In order to do your projects, because we were doing magazines, we were doing videos. So you need to edit, you need to use Photoshop, InDesign, and Illustrator, and other like Adobe programs.
Yeah,
that was called. Yeah, so it was a big difference for me for masters, because I started reading a lot. We were writing a lot. We had so many projects, and I was studying from 8 to 5 or 6 every day, like working day. I mean. And then you have a lot of projects, you do different kind of study trips. We also, like, the coolest thing for the Sotheby's Institute of Art is that you go to Venice for Biennale. Biennale is a very important cultural event for the contemporary art.
Ukraine took part in that?
So many times.
Yeah, but basically it was very big this year, apparently. I don't even know why, but everyone's talking about it, so.
Yeah, because we kind of got the first time a really good place, so I think a space
within the,
yeah.
Biennale, because it's a big pavilion,
yeah,
right?
No,
and you
no.
can go.
It's like a big open space, and you have different pavilions. And many countries, they have their own pavilions. For example, there is a Russian pavilion which was cancelled, and they didn't perform this year. And the main point about Russian pavilions that it was constructed and funded by the Ukrainian mecenate, or how it's called.
Sponsor,
like a sponsor during the king's empire, like king's time, or
oh yeah, tsar, yeah,
so
it's a specific
Soviet,
Russian thing
before the Soviet Union. one of Ukrainians, wealthy man, he kind of did a project, he paid for Ukrainian pavilion, so it should be kind of Ukrainian, but because it was a Russian empire, they called it Russian pavilion. And
well, just basically because Ukraine was occupied by Russia.
Yeah, but then at the end you started thinking about historical reassessment, and maybe it's right to be a Russian one because it was done in Russian empire, not like Ukrainian empire at that time. Yeah, so kind of I started business in art, and I started studying a lot, reading about economics and stuff. And then Excel was something new for me. I never
Excel.
Used
Excel.
Yeah, I never used it before. I don't really even knew how to use those kind of formulas to calculate stuff. Like, it's not so easy if people think that it's like.
You know, honestly, like, even when I do my internships, every single time they ask for Excel, and I pretend as if I know how to do that and kind of learn on the way in case I need it. Most of the time, you don't need it.
So there's a big difference because the masters were really academic, and then my BA was more practical thing. So I kind of have combinations of different aspects. Then I did photography, graphic design, marketing, PR, styling, art history, business, art law, authenticity, and many, many stuff. So I kind of have possibility right now to choose where I want to move. And so it made my life easier, and I feel I became more mature after master's.
As much as your kind of skills and abilities have grown over those years, your mindset in general has grown as well. And I wanted to ask, how did your Ukrainian heritage translate into your professional mindset and working habits? And what were sort of main features in how you were bringing your culture in your projects and in your work, in your communication with people? What maybe was a cultural shock for you in the industry or university?
So it's many, many questions, honestly. I'm gonna choose few of them because I cannot focus on all of them at the same time to answer. So first off, I wanna say that when you go to the creative unis abroad, you can see Russian-speaking people, or like Ukrainian, post-Soviet Union people, because they are usually doing projects connected to their heritage. They really, and their professors are really happy to see such projects about their culture and stuff, because it's not so kind of open to the British people, I think. So I wasn't sure if I should tell this or not, but I was kind of really interested in Soviet Union and how it was, because I never lived there. I don't know how it was. Of course, I was studying history, you know, how many things, bad things was happening, but still at the same time it was really interesting stylistically for me. So I kind of, and majority of my friends, we did projects connected to the communism and stuff, not like saying that it was cool or something, like the clothes that people were wearing,
just the aesthetic and the cultural
aesthetic, because we still have this aesthetic in Ukraine, some kind of old buildings
just called
old,
modernism.
Yeah, so it was kind of influencing me because it was so interesting for me, and it was different from the projects that other international students were doing, and I was like, oh, I'm more unique and stuff. And then when the war started, everything changed. But I also were using pagans in my projects and shoes because I love kind of this magical vibes and stuff. I don't know, it's so interesting for me still. And then Ukrainian embroidery and Ukrainian national clothes, I thought that it's very cool, it's very stylistically beautiful. Then also walked it, this kind of Ukrainian shoot, and it was amazing. I was like really inspired, and I was like, oh, I want to do something similar. So my heritage really influenced mentality. Of course, it's different, but I think the more you live in UK, the more you're gonna use to their mentality, and your mentality is changing, and you're not kind of fully Ukrainian anymore, and like your relationships are changing, your behavior with friends are changing, your mind is changing as well, and like mindset overall, and also the way you're gonna think about your future career, your family. Like, you're not planning to marry at 21 anymore, you're not planning to have 55 kids. So
never been planning on that. Obviously, you mentioned that the start of the war has changed a lot in your perception of what projects you want to do. Tell me more about how did you kind of conquer the fear in your head? How were you dealing with this, and how it influenced, most importantly, your practice?
So actually, when the war started, I was in your place. I remember I was staying for a few days. I was just crying, checking news, and it was my reading week, so I wasn't studying and going to lectures for a week. So I had enough time to kind of calm, understand what's going on, blah blah blah. And then when I went to uni, everyone was just asking me, like, how are you feeling? Where is your family? Is everyone safe? Blah, blah, blah. And then lots of your friends are texting, like, oh, my family's in Kharkov. I don't know what to do. Can you help me? They need specific medicine, which just was, like, I told you the story about one of my friends that I was searching a medicine for her grandparents. If we couldn't find it, they will die. And, like, it's so stressful. It's so difficult even to understand, to see how many people died, how many, like, these explosions... news, it was just like overwhelming me, and my mind changed. I started thinking about how to do projects related to war. So first of all, I did kind of the concept for exhibition, different stages of your mind when you're going through the grief and you're going through the shock, anger and stuff during the war. I'm not gonna tell all the concepts because someone gonna use it. Only on Patreon people.
Patreon.
Yeah.
The secret part of the podcast.
Yeah. But we are not having this stuff right
Unfortunately,
now.
Not yet.
Maybe in the
not
future.
Yet. Okay. Back to the topic.
After 6 months of war, I decided that I want to write my dissertation about Ukrainian art and the influence of war on Ukrainian art, Ukrainian industry, inside of Ukraine, outside of Ukraine, Ukrainian art market.
That was your master's dissertation.
Yeah. So kind of this topic was really connected to the Eastern European art, Russian umbrella, the influence, diversification, our history, different kind of connection to the Georgian art and other Eastern European art, how the industry is treating it, also historical reassessment. So for example, we know that the artwork of Degas, Ukrainian dancers, it used to be called Russian dancers, and because of the Ukrainian national clothes, this, how do you call this?
Veils. Not veils. No. It's the...
Stop
veils saying, is the marriage.
You should put the veil here, please. Okay, so it's like...
it's a head decoration.
Head decoration with flowers, which is like Ukrainian, not Russian. And so because of this historical aspect that Ukrainian troops, dance troops, were coming to Paris and Degas saw them dancing.
I'm sorry, I just imagine like dancers in like arms with weapons going on Paris.
But it's called...
to Ukraine. No, it is troops. It is dance troops. It's just, it's just funny. Okay, okay.
We appreciate military and all that. Ukrainian armed forces are doing right now. They're like heroes.
No,
like,
I feel
don't take it. It's like
I feel like it's
joke.
Just a. I'm not a really serious person, but I feel like it's just a very good insight on how Ukrainians cope with war. We make bad jokes. For some people, they might seem offensive or uncomfortable, and they
mm-hmm.
don't feel comfortable to laugh at this. But it's funny for us because it's our situation, and it's. I feel like it's still. Ethical to do so, whatever.
So coming back to the topic, so the artwork of Degas, Russian dancers were renamed to the Ukrainian dancers. It's very big thing for Ukrainian art because historical reassessments and different stuff. So it's like, so I was kind of collecting this influences, changes, opinions. I also did an interview with the Ministry of Culture of Ukraine, with representative of Ukrainian Institute, the director of Ukrainian Institute, the British gallerist of Ukrainian art, the gallerist who was representing Ukraine Biennale, the gallery.
I didn't know that.
You were helping me with types of.
Yeah, but
text.
I didn't know who he was. It was just it was just the name for me, and I was listening. And
yeah, and I was really happy to talk to them. I never met such people. Before, because I wasn't really working in Ukraine with art, and then also when I was kind of searching for the people who I want to interview, my mom, she offered me to go for work in the cultural fund. It's like a charity foundation which have an art project within it.
What's the name of the foundation?
So it's Kozelski Charity Foundation,
and we're gonna put the link below.
be enrolled project. And right now I'm working with them for 8 months. I'm really happy, but it's kind of and tough and fun in the same time.
To sum up, Karina has two jobs right now. The first job is for Kozetsky Foundation.
Charity Foundation.
Tell me about what your job is in the Kozetsky Charity Foundation.
So basically I started as an assistant of curator. I was helping with different projects, and the whole mission of the project, the main mission of the project is to promote Ukrainian art abroad and do different charity exhibitions around the world. So we travel to New York, Lugano, Switzerland, and like different countries and cities. And then I became a co-curator. So I started writing my curatorial essays and thinking about concepts, collecting artworks. I mean, not like collecting as a collector, I'm just collecting choosing them for the project. Then we were doing different auctions. So it was really interesting, but at the same time I was writing my diploma, so it was kind of overwhelming. Because when you do so many academic things, it's kind of messing up in your head. And then right now I'm part-time working with them, working on the London's project, which is going to be on 27th of April in the Shoreditch downstairs in Mother. Please, everyone who wants can join, and you're welcome. You can write her or me. And like,
if you want to meet Karina or myself, or you want to see the exhibition just for the sake of it,
or to support Ukrainian art and buy something.
We're definitely going to be updating about this exhibition on our channel and our social media, that I'll put the link down below too. Okay, and now we are switching to your other job I always struggle saying his name. It's James Butterwick.
Right.
Yes. So he's a British art dealer who works with Ukrainian art, with not specifically with artists, just the art that he could find. He owns a lot of it. Just to understand what his he owns a gallery, and he also has a collection of art that he sells and buys all the time.
You're right with everything you said. And he kind of works with a modern artist, avant-garde. He used to work with a Russian artist, but right now it's not so many Russian artists. It's more like the artists who was born in Ukraine, but they were part of the Soviet Union. That's why they called them Russian artists. But he's working on historical reassessment. And for example, Bohomazov, he was kind of Russian artist, but he changed it. And right now everyone knows that Bohomazov is Ukrainian artist. And also we have like online exhibition of another artist who was also kind of Russian artist, but he is Ukrainian born. So
there are so many creators. Gogol, Malevich.
Malevich was kind of Polish, I think.
Yeah, his parents were Polish, but he was born in Ukraine. And then
he was working in Kyiv, and he wrote in his diaries that he's Ukrainian, and then he was repressed. He went to the, not kind of, I don't remember if he went to prison or something, but he was repressed for his opinion of being Ukrainian.
I also think I saw an Instagram post, like infographics, about all the artists that used to be called Russian, but they're actually born in Ukraine. I'll try to find the link to it.
Yeah, and what is my experience of working with him? So I just started a week ago, so I can't say like a big thing, but the way that people are treating you here, I believe it's more very polite, very official. You're all the time writing official letters, which we don't do in Ukraine if you are in the same team. Of course, we are using WhatsApp or something to just text, but if you need something official, they can write me a mail and ask me for something. So I don't overwork. I work only for the hours I'm allowed to work. The way he's behaving and the way I feel he's my boss, I just really kind of appreciate everything that he's doing and that he took me for this job, because I'm not so experienced in art and I'm just like fresh Ukrainian arts professional who's not so professional till then, but still like I have a good education, so I believe I deserve to work with him, and I'm really happy for this opportunity. But in Ukraine you usually overwork, people can talk rude to you at work, and you cannot do anything with this. Yeah, of course we have law which that they are not allowed to talk to you by like this. But if you're gonna go to the court and do something, I believe that people with connections who kind of have businesses or who kind of both us and older ones, they can make everything to make you a loser, and in the end no one's gonna take you to the work.
Not to say that it's corrupt, but basically it's such a small matter for like all the people that they would just laugh at you and say you don't have enough reasons to bring it to court, and they would do everything possible not to do the work and not to kind of tie it to any specific law, so you can't really win anything out of it. But also there are so many other issues, like for example, it's not really sustainable to you to bring anyone to court because basically it's the influence on your reputation in the future, while also there's not as much work in art industry in Ukraine, so everyone working in there values it so much.
And everyone knows each other, so that's...
Yeah. And
of course in London everyone knows each other, but still
not as much. There's also a lot of competition, and if you were working for someone and they treat you badly, you can go to the competitor and say, I was working for them, and they take you. I want to ask you about a practical part of the work. Tell me about one project, apart from your dissertation, within university that you were most proud of, and then one project in your professional career that you're most proud of.
So I think because I'm really visual person and I love beautiful videos and paintings and stuff, I'm not gonna talk about MA because I was doing different projects, but it was more writing, so I'm not gonna tell you the essay I was writing about. So I can come back to the BA and say that when I was doing my diploma for the bachelor's, I did a lot of shoots, and I did a shoot with a girl who I was talking about, who you're gonna interview in the future.
Hopefully.
I think so. So we did a very beautiful campaign about nature and different air, earth, water and fire science. It was beautiful. Then I did the kind of bordel, how do you call that? Renaissance bordel.
It was not a bordel, it's a public house.
Yeah, so it was like a Renaissance public house, and I did like a whole story about the drama that there were like a wealthy man and his assistant. They came from work to relax, because at that time, if you're gonna read the books of Hemingway and to others, you like not.
I still think we need to emphasize that we're talking about like prostitutes here and courtesans.
Yeah. So. Not that books. Yeah, of course the vibe of the Paris was really similar for those kind of public places that they have there. We kind of did it in strip club in Lviv, and then
that's the opportunities you get in Ukraine. You can literally rent out the entire strip club for the shoot, which is made by basically like a student at the time. Obviously, it wasn't for free, but yeah.
Yeah, so in the end of the day, I bought alcohol, like a bottle of whiskey, beautiful one, to put on the set. And models started drinking it, and they got drunk. It was really fun. And one of the models, she kind of broke the lamp, the lighting, because she kind of accidentally pushed it, and it's kind of worked, and it was so fun.
What were the actual consequences of that? You just escaped and nobody talked about it?
No, it wasn't like it was rented by photographers, so I paid for it. So the worthless part is that you need to pay for everything, even in fashion industry, if you want to have a really good set. Then I had another project, which is going to be video that Olya going to publish, about pagans and this kind of mystic Ukrainian embroidery. I don't remember what was the whole topic that I needed to be stick to, but I kind of started filming. I did makeups for all the models. I rented embroidery, like a traditional Ukrainian clothes. I took three boys to assist us. I had two videographers and their assistants. I had three cars or two cars, I don't remember. So I kind of took everything to them. Lake, and the weather was bad. We couldn't find the way how to get to the lake because I forgot how to get there, and no one, like all the people are from Lviv, and no one knew how to get there. Then it was so cold. They were like saying me, oh, we don't want to work. We don't want to shoot anything. It's so cold. The weather is so bad. Stylistically and for the picture, it was nice. But then for them, it was so awful. Then one of my friends got stuck in the sand and she lost her shoe. But in the end of the day, I kind of arrived home and my friend, who was videographer, she started filming. I did a decoration and set up the kind of this atmosphere at home, and she filmed me, and then we went to the balcony and she filled me with the mirror and water. So in the end, like, the picture is nice, but no one knows how many struggles you have in the shoot. Like, it's fun, but it can be really difficult sometimes, and you spend a lot of money. It's also
like, what's the approximate total sum of the shoot?
So for UK, it's not so much, around £500 or £600.
Well, I mean, to be honest, I don't think that a single like student in university can afford paying £500 or £600 for a shoot, even if it's for their dissertation. I think there are options to like find funding within university, but obviously there is no such thing in Ukraine.
Yeah, but I was so into my project that I decided to spend all my saved money for this in order to have like a beautiful portfolio and like to find a job of my life.
What is the job project that you're most proud of, like from the curating? Mm-hmm.
So I haven't done any kind of curation project just by myself. I mean, independently as a Karina, as a, me as a brand. I was just working for the End of World project. I was really proud of myself when I was going to US. I did like 8 or 10 exhibitions by myself. So maybe less, I don't know, I don't remember, but at least I remember that I kind of unpacked everything, I set up the exhibition, I sold artworks, I packed everything, and I was really doing it so fast. The orchestra, they were traveling around, they had a tour around the US, and they were performing there, Ukrainian music and different other music, and then we had exhibitions in foyer, and I was doing those exhibitions. And it was so difficult to do it by yourself. You were like, in the morning, you had this kind of pain in your body because you're the girl who were just like taking up the artworks, which is really heavy, and then like a huge boxes here, packing everything. It's like, we had exhibition in Carnegie Hall, and I met the representative of Ukraine in our United Nations, and I was so proud of myself, honestly.
How did it happen? Did you just came up to him and said hi?
No, he came to me.
Oh, really? He was asking about the artworks.
Yeah, so they were looking for representatives, and other of my colleagues, they were somewhere else, I don't remember. And then he came
we
and...
We were in the right place at the right time.
Yeah, it matters. So he came and he was like, if you want, you can do an exhibition in our place. And he gave me his card and he was like, it's my assistant, talk to her. And like, text with her. And I texted her and like, oh, hi, let's do. And that's how I did the exhibition in the United Nations.
So, and our final question is, Karina, what would be the one ultimate advice you want to give our fellow Ukrainian creators for them to become as successful as you are?
So maybe take all opportunities you have and don't be shy to talk to people. There is no bad comments that you can, like, any critics, everything can be really beneficial for you. And then no one gonna judge you for asking for something. If you're gonna ask and they're gonna say no, at least you know that, like, that they don't want to do it. And like, no one gonna tell you no because you're like a very bad person, I don't wanna work with you, not gonna have any kind of project. They just gonna tell you, oh, we don't have time, or like, we don't have any funds to do this project. And that's it. Like, try everything you want. And then the funny thing that I wanna tell, if you know what you wanna do or who you wanna be, fake it until you make it. That's it.
Yeah, that's why I'm sitting here all cool, pretending as if my podcast is very profound. What is your plan for the nearest future in your career? And what do you think the future of Ukrainian art will be?
So, first of all, I want to tell that I'm not like kind of planning all my life because everything is changing rapidly. And I wasn't expecting to sit here and like do interview, even like about how successful I am, because I don't think that I'm successful, but still, thank you. So My goal overall is to become a minister of culture in Ukraine and to be a director of a department of Eastern European art and syllabus. It's like my kind of big goals, and to have my own business. But a part of it, I was thinking right now, I'm kind of trying to work on the laws, art laws in Ukraine, and I wanna study it and like create some laws for it. Then what is the future of Ukrainian art business? I hope, because when I talked with the Minister of Culture, he told me that there are many things going on, that they are doing archive, like a huge online database, and I hope they're gonna do it because it's very important for us, even the issues with the UNESCO heritage in Ukraine. Everything is changing, and I believe after war and after our victory, Ukraine gonna have opportunity. Of course, we're gonna need to have 5 or 10 years for the reconstruction and stuff, but I hope that our industries will develop much more better. And also this kind of loss, he told me that they kind of don't have time to work on them, but they will maybe work on them. So I hope they're gonna do everything they kind of promised me that they're working on. And I hope that it's gonna be paid fair for all the artists and all arts professionals.
That's it? That's the...
I saw that you're not recording.
I'm recording.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm honestly impressed, because even though I know this person for quite a while and we're very, very close, I'd say I am still shocked by how impressive and empowering and just inspiring for me personally this woman is. And just I love her with my whole heart. And I really hope that you also had a chance to get a glimpse of my beautiful friend Karina. And I will obviously link all of the social media and her projects.
Yeah, follow my Instagram, please. Many followers.
on our website, and also in description of this video. Thank you very much.